The next item on the order paper is a motion on the threats to the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. As 2 amendments have been selected and are published on the marshalled list, an additional 15 minutes have been added to the total time. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. The proposer of each amendment will have 10 minutes to propose and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Before we begin, the House should note that the amendments are mutually exclusive, so if Amendment 1 is made, the question will not be put on Amendment 2. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes the crucial and life-saving role of the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service in responding to fires, road traffic collisions, other specialist rescue incidents and in providing community safety education. Expresses regret that it has not been considered a frontline service by the current Minister of Health, Social Services and Public Safety. Further notes with concern that changes to service delivery have compromised the safety of the public and the officers who deliver the service. Believes that any future changes to service delivery should not compromise further the safety of the public or the officers. Further expresses deep concern at the major deterioration in attendance times over the last 5 years, particularly delays in the first appliance reaching high-risk cases. Notes that projected cuts to the service have already resulted in up to 7 stations being identified for downgrading, 4 other stations identified as being high-risk not being upgraded, and warnings of further reduced response times, and calls on the Minister of Health, Social Services and Public Safety to change his position and appreciate the importance of the service so that there is no further risk to public safety.
Motion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. It is with no pleasure at all that I have to move this motion on such a serious issue and which contains such serious warnings in this House today. But before I get to the substance of this debate, I would like to warmly welcome our colleagues from the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service who have come to Parliament Buildings today, and many of them join us in the public gallery. It is my hope that their presence will not only serve as a reminder that the cuts have left no constituency untouched, but that behind the statistics, these are men and women facing increasingly difficult circumstances in their endeavours to keep the public safe. It is my genuine hope that all those parties who willingly wanted to be photographed with the firefighters outside the chamber will support the motion inside it here today. Everyone in this House should be under no illusions about the pressures currently being applied onto the service. In what I believe to have been one of the starkest warnings so far, in a recent letter from the Interim Chief Fire and Rescue Officer Dale Ashford to a senior official in the Department of Health, dated the 9th of December 2015, Mr. Ashford said, and I quote, "A budget reduction of either 5% or 10% within the 2016-2017 financial year would have a devastating impact on the operations of the Fire and Rescue Service. It would not only result in the service failing to meet its statutory requirements, but would also impact on response time to emergency incidents and the level of resilience in Northern Ireland. The service would seek to mitigate the impact on the public and firefighter safety and the risk analysis of actions required to deliver a 5% savings within one financial year would result in unacceptable risk levels." Say it again, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, unacceptable risk levels. That's it there in black and white. The most senior fire officer in the country, a man with nearly 30 years' experience of protecting our community, effectively pleading with government to show some sense. Can this Assembly really sit back and let such warnings go unheeded? It was therefore with some bewilderment that I read the DUP amendment to the motion today. The very first line in it stressing the importance of the Fire and Rescue Service as a key frontline service. They're absolutely right. However, I suspect that even some of the DUP benches will be aware that the reason the Fire and Rescue Service are even facing a further cut next year is because they are not considered frontline service by the Health Minister. Members, that's essentially the crux of the issue. The Executive previously decided to protect frontline services within the health budget, but then the Minister, for whatever reason, decided the Fire and Rescue Service didn't deserve or merit that protection. So it's my genuine hope that this amendment, rather than representing a mere drafting oversight by the party, is actually an indication from the Minister that he has at last listened. If it isn't, and it's only been used as a cynical or tactical exercise to politically save face, then shame on them and shame on the proposers of it. In a briefing circulated last week by the Fire Brigades Union, a body of which I'm sure we can all agree have done a first-rate job in highlighting the severity of the problem, it laid out exactly what is at risk. They summed it up as, and I quote, "The cuts of the magnitude proposed would see potential station closures, station downgrades and firefighters' numbers slashed." Indeed, the briefing that they prepared and circulated to all MLAs should have been enough to send shivers down the spine of any member that took the time to read through it. Unfortunately, however, much of what will be talked about today will have already been known this time last year, when the 2015-2016 budget allocations were being decided. In fact, some may recall, the Ulster Unionist Party attempted to amend last year's budget to increase the Fire Service and the Fire Service and Service allocation by £1.5 million by using some of the untouched funding within the Social Investment Fund. The DUP dismissed this amendment and even tried to suggest we are taking the money away from community groups. But look at what was revealed only last week. OFM DFM has still only managed to spend £4 million of the £80 million. Do the MLAs who got so worked up about our amendment last year still think leaving the money to language in a central pot was better than actually investing in our rescue services? And I ask each of them to reach down into their conscience for the answer to that one. Of course they don't. They were blindly following party orders. The Fire Brigades Union warned last year what would happen with a further cut. And unfortunately, we're now in the unenviable situation of having an even greater understaffed service, as well as several towns across Northern Ireland that have been classed as high risk, having no full-time fire cover. Sometimes this Assembly hears of examples of postcode lotteries, and this is a prime example of one where people's lives are being placed at risk. Of course, not only do we not have enough full-time firefighters, indeed, with the proposed cuts, suspect redundancies would be inevitable, and I suspect not all of them would be voluntary. The list of potential downgrades, Armagh, Antrim, Carrickfergus, Coleraine, Omagh and Newton Ards, also extends to Portadown in my own constituency. Last February, I visited the crew in Portadown and have previously visited Drumore Station and joined the large animal rescue squad based in Newcastle Fire Station on training. Sitting here today, we can have very little comprehension of the scenes which these brave men and women are faced with in the course of their duties, and that many lives in the communities they serve. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, it's difficult to put into words the emotions they must go through in the course of those duties. They are very clear in their priorities, and that's saving lives. Their message to me on numerous occasions has been that they have already been working hard to deliver efficiencies in recent years, but these should be agreed, not forced. If members have not already done so, I would urge you to spend some time out with these fantastic men and women. As I have, you will learn some very important lessons about duty, honour and respect, and I firmly believe that these lessons should go both ways. Another alarming consequence of what we are talking about today is the deterioration over recent years in attendance times. We'll all be well aware that the service deals with far more than house fires, As the motion says, they play a key role in responding to road traffic collisions, and over the years, these priorities are themselves changing. Whatever the circumstances, however, when a life or a person's safety is imminently at risk, there simply cannot be any delays. Unfortunately, however, in response to an Assembly question from my party last year, the Minister confirmed that in 2011-2012, when the overall service revenue budget was £81 million, 77% of the first appliances in high-risk situation arrived within the first target of 6 minutes. By 2014-2015, this had fallen to only 59%. Equivalent drops occurred for the second appliances, and again, both in high-risk and medium-risk situations. I would remind the House that in the years from 2011 to 2012, the services budget has been cut by almost £12 million, and that's before inflation is even factored in. If the Minister attempts to argue later that budget cuts have not compromised the safety of either the public or the personnel within the service, aside from being widely discredited, I would ask him to explain what he therefore thinks is responsible for people having to wait longer before emergency help arrives. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I hope this is a worthwhile debate and one which this House uses to send a clear message to Simon Hamilton that the current situation is simply not good enough. And in fact, what he appears to be on the verge of doing for next year will only make things many times worse. I would urge the Minister, with all sincerity, to think again. A service which protects us deserves itself to be protected. Thank you.
Call Mr. Fergal McKinney to move Amendment number 1.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity as health spokesperson for the SDLP to move today's amendment on such an important issue and to stress the need to have proper funding for our fire and rescue service so that it can provide a vital frontline service that is best able to protect the public and ensure that firefighters' own safety is not put at risk. Principal Deputy Speaker, I'd first like to take this opportunity to offer my condolences to the family and friends of Ellen Finnegan, who tragically lost her life at the weekend in a fire in Castlewell, and our thoughts and prayers are with Ellen's family at this time of great sadness and despair. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, unfortunately, in this case it was too late for the fire service to make a difference, but I'd like to pay tribute to the many firefighters across Northern Ireland who make such a significant contribution to our society. We're all very aware of the dangers of fire and of how dependent we are when disaster strikes on the skills and courage of our firefighters. They put their lives at risk to protect the public, and their professionalism and dedication to saving lives never fails to impress me, and I'm sure that applies to all of those in the chamber and the wider public. Firefighters provide a vital and extremely important frontline service, and they are there at every fire and every incident across Northern Ireland, and I'm glad, as has been reflected, that so many of them have come here to Stormont today to voice their very real concerns in person on the detrimental impact that next year's budget will have on their ability to provide these services. Last year alone, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, firefighters here responded to a total of nearly 23,000 emergency incidents across Northern Ireland. That's including road traffic collisions, rescues, flooding, and of course, we've all recently witnessed that. They respond to fires, of course, building collapses, and the list goes on. Firefighters really are on the front line when emergency situations strike and when the public's lives are put on the line. And no other incident exemplifies their dedication and bravery than having to attend a scene just before Christmas involving one of their own, Eugene McNally, who died in such tragic circumstances in a road crash on the A1. It's therefore vitally important that this Assembly shows its appreciation for the invaluable services that the Fire Service provides. And I would like to thank Mrs. Dobson and Mr. McGimsey for bringing today's motion. However, we believe there is something of a fundamental flaw at the heart of the original motion, and that is around the understanding that the Health Minister alone has the remit or authority to ring defence funding for the fire service in the terms that were led to the cut. During last year's budget deliberations, we heard from the Minister's predecessor, Mr Wells, that the decision to give the fire service budgetary protection as a frontline service was for the executive to decide, and the executive had made that decision. And that's why we've amended today's motion. However, the SDLP believes that the Fire and Rescue Service is a frontline service, a service that wholly deserves the same budgetary protection as other vital frontline health and social care services, and that's why we believe it is extremely important to bring this amendment. And if we look at the Department's definition of a frontline service provided by Mr Wells, the then Health Minister, during his tenure as Minister, it's easy to see why one would call the fire service frontline and why its budget deserves to be ring-fenced. At that time, in an answer to a question from myself, he replied that frontline service, in terms of a definition, was a complex concept which comprises a closely integrated team of staff who have direct contact with patients, clients and families, together with other staff who provide a wide range of critical support activities to facilitate that direct contact and expenditure on health promotion activities. And I think, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, on every call out, the fire service are directly involved with the public in providing life-saving services. Last year alone, the fire service attended 720 road traffic collisions, working in close collaboration with the ambulance service and other health professionals to ensure the best possible outcome for patients. The patient will not get to the doctor out of a car in a car crash unless the fire service releases them. That's why they're the front line, in a very practical way. Without this work, Mr Speaker, many people living here involved in accidents would not be alive today. So I ask the Minister and his executive colleagues, why is it that the fire service is facing a budget cut as a non-frontline service? It's also arguable, Mr Speaker, that the fire service are engaged in vital health promotion and public safety activities. Activities around prevention and early intervention in cases of an emergency. Last year alone, they carried out 7,000 home fire safety checks and installed 5,000 smoke alarms in some for the most at risk and vulnerable people in society. And as our older population continues to grow, so does dementia, and that's a vital link for those who would find themselves unable to recognise the danger that is in their own home, even when it reaches a crisis point. For me, Mr Speaker, there is no other logical conclusion than to designate the fire service as frontline in terms of health and safety, and this needs to be ultimately recognised and supported by our executive in ring-fencing their funding. Can I turn to the DUP's amendment to today's motion and the importance it places on ensuring that any service cuts do not compromise public safety? Having met with the Fire Brigade Union and listen to the views of the Chief Fire Officer, they've sent very severe and stark warnings that further budget cuts will place communities across Northern Ireland at risk. It calls on the NIFRS to be categorised as frontline, but then doesn't draw the connection to the budget, and neither does it draw the connection to the depletion of service. Over the last 5 years, our Fire and Rescue Service has had to deal with year-on-year cuts to its budget. From 2011-12 to 2015-16, the NIFRS budget had been cut by £12 million, or 14.5%. This proposal will put an extra 5.6% cut on that. That means, since 2012, the Fire Service will have faced a budget cut of 20%. And as Mrs Dobson says, there is a real question about provision. And that's not just the provision of the health and safety aspect, but the provision when it comes to saving lives. These cuts have already had a detrimental impact on the ability of the fire service, as I said, to adequately cover certain areas. And there are now real concerns over areas like Strabane, Downpatrick, Dungannon, Enniskillen, which are without full-time cover. In 1984, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, there was an assessment done of the needs around fire cover. It recommended that fire service cover in places like Enniskillen should be full-time, and none of that has happened. It has been retained throughout most of the last 31 years. The Fire Brigade Union and the Chief Executive have said a further 5.6% cut, as proposed in the new budget, would not only mean that the service would be unable to meet its statutory requirements. I think I should repeat that. A further 5% cut would mean that the service would be unable to meet its statutory requirements. But, it adds, it would also severely impact response times to emergency incidents and the levels of resilience in Northern Ireland. This cut would lead to the loss of 67 full-time firefighter posts, the closure of 3 one-pump stations or one full multi-pump station and one pump station. And could the Minister potentially in his remarks point out which stations they would be? How can he ensure that there will be no risk to public safety? And I think it's worthwhile repeating that question. Can the Minister give us a guarantee today, as a result of these budget cuts, that there will be no risk to public safety and firefighter safety with such reductions? The Minister, in justifying his cuts, will tell us there's no operational threat, but these warnings from the key fire service unions suggest otherwise. So I cannot accept the DUP amendment, consistent as it is with attempting to recognise the front line, but not underscoring the budget need as a result. The fire service here also has additional statutory obligations, which includes flooding, rescue and large animal rescue, and those, by the way, are in addition to what fire provision is in the rest of the UK. So we have additional statutory responsibilities here. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, what I've tried to emphasise over the past couple of years, and particularly with the discussion around budget reductions and reorganisation, is that we need to think strategically. And I do believe that the Fire Brigade Union and those in charge would be willing to look at other options around potential investment to save programmes. But in the meantime, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, we have a situation where people's lives are being put at risk as a result of these budget proposals. Thank you very much.
I call Mr. Gary Middleton to move amendment number 2.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I rise to move the DUP amendment to this motion. I wish to begin by paying tribute to all our firefighters throughout Northern Ireland who serve and protect our communities on a daily basis, quite often putting themselves in danger to protect members of the public and property. And indeed, it's great to see so many firefighters gathered here this afternoon. Whilst there is a section of the motion which I tend to agree with, I wish to propose the DUP amendment on behalf of myself and DUP colleagues and fellow colleagues of the Health Committee as well. This amendment better reflects the situation and how we can best assist and support the Northern Ireland Fire Service to improve it. Nobody in this chamber will doubt the brave work that our firefighters do, and indeed within my own constituency in Foyle I've worked very closely with many of our local fire officers on several occasions, and I've seen firsthand the work and the fantastic work that they do. Whether it be from the Crescent Link station in Londonderry, who last year responded to over 600 incidents ranging from major fires to road traffic collisions, or from the Northland station, who responded to over 1,200. Anything which we agree to or support in this Assembly must never compromise public safety, and any savings proposals, of course, should be prioritised on the basis of minimising the impact of service delivery. This is something that I know the Health Minister has been outlining for some considerable time. He has also stated that any changes to service delivery will be risk assessed to ensure that ensure the continued safety of both the public and firefighters. In relation to the budget, the 7 stations referred to are not being downgraded as a result of the budget. The Fire Service risk assessment found that it would be better to change the crewing rota of the 7 stations and be able to introduce whole-time crews at the 4 stations at Strabann, Enniskillen, Dungannon and Downpatrick. I am aware that this is currently out for consultation and will be closing in the not-too-distant future. The response of that, of course, will be a matter for the Fire Service to assess. I believe it is very dangerous to directly suggest the reduction in the budget will compromise public safety and the safety of fire officers. In terms of our amendment to this motion before us, we hope that... No, I'm not going to give way. In terms of our amendment to the motion before us, we hope that this Assembly will support it and publicly confirm that we consider the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service, along with the ambulance service and policing as well, to be key frontline services. believing, of course, that any change to service delivery should not compromise the safety of officers or the public. We also welcome the 26% reduction in fire service mobilisation undertaken in Northern Ireland since 2010-11, but we also urge caution against comparison with these figures with figures in England, as, of course, there are specific factors here in Northern Ireland. No, I'm not going to give way. We want to further ensure that enhanced emergency capability is provided where need is identified, in South Down and the west of the province, including Enniskillen and Dungannon stations, ensuring that any proposals for efficiency savings required by the executive will be considered where they do not compromise public or firefighter safety. On previous occasions, the Minister has stated publicly that joint-up working and collaboration is key within the Health Department, ultimately offering significant potential. This is something that I want to see not only within the Health Department, but indeed every department within the Executive. If anything is to be achieved by this Assembly today, it should be about reaffirming our commitment that public or firefighter safety must not be compromised. That too has been reaffirmed by the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service, who, when publishing the consultation and proposed new changes, stated that, and I quote, "We have clearly identified a change in the risk profile in Northern Ireland, and we need to adapt and remain flexible to the changing needs we face. So, like all of our frontline services, when the need changes, the services must be flexible to adapt." And I have full faith that the Health Minister will do all he can, and is doing all he can, to support our frontline services, including the Fire and Rescue Service. So in closing, I do hope that parties will not use this issue as a political football and will work together with the Minister to do the best possible for our health service. And indeed, I hope the members in this chamber can support our amendment. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Ms Maeve McLaughlin.
Glasgow Corner, and I welcome this opportunity to speak on what is an important debate, and I want to acknowledge the not only the fire service themselves who are here today. I also want to acknowledge the role of the proposer of the motion of bringing it to the floor of the House today. And I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak on what is an important debate as Sinn Féin's health spokesperson. I don't think anyone in society can or could be in any doubt of the life-saving and vital role played by our fire service. And I rise in support of both the motion and indeed the amendment as tabled by Mr McKinney, Mr Diver and Mr Dallet. And I think it is, I suppose, important to point out when I listened to the previous speaker in relation to the DUP amendment, I question, can anybody actually stand hand on heart and say that a reduction in £12 million in a budget isn't having a detrimental impact in relation to this service? And I suggest that the members opposite reflect long and hard on that, because clearly the evidence in front of us today and indeed on a daily basis in our streets, our cities and our towns points to that detrimental impact. And it's very clear that the Chief Fire Officer, they are very clear on the effect the cuts are having. And it has been well documented in relation to this particular financial year. The figures clearly demonstrate that the fire service is a cost-effective service. And as it stands, the service no longer, for example, in my own constituency, can primarily crew aerial appliances. They can neither do that in Derry or do it in Belfast. And I point this out, that this means that appliances that are designated to save lives from multi-storey buildings are often left in stations with their trained crews out on other appliances dealing with incidents. And I say this, Mr. Principal's Deputy Speaker, that an example of this was in my own city just last year, at a very serious blaze in a Chinese restaurant, where crews had to leave the incident to go back to their station to get the appliance. That is very clearly a risk situation for the crew and indeed the wider public, and simply, in my view, not acceptable. It has been alluded to that the fire service have additional statutory responsibilities. from rescues from serious flooding, and they have not received any additional funding for additional statutory duties. And I do think that we have to reflect on the issue of cost. The cost of the service here breaks down to 11 pence per day, compared to 13 pence per day in Britain. This, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, represents real value for money. Because unlike regions within Britain, who rely on drawing on the resources and personnel of neighbouring regions to meet a large-scale emergency, this service here is largely stand-alone, with some, but very limited, cross-border cooperation. And I did think it was quite stark when I reflected on an issue that was brought to my attention by the service themselves. The fire service here must stockpile more foam, because if they run out, which has happened, an electrical fire has had to be left to burn until more foam could be brought from Britain by ferry. I ask anybody in the chamber to suggest or indicate that this is somehow not a detrimental impact, or at least it does not increase risk. And we do need to reflect on the facts. And they are quite stark, and some members have alluded to them previously. But injuries are up 43 to 559, the highest in 5 years. Rescues are up 29 to 208, the highest in 5 years. In addition, attendances to road traffic collisions increased by 34 to 701.
I ask the member to conclude her remarks.
I will conclude my remarks.
I will give way.
Speaker, to the member, I did hear speaking about the statutory duties. As someone who represents a large rural constituency, would you care to comment on what impact it could have on constituents like large animal rescues, where we might actually endanger lives of farmers and farm families in an attempt to rescue if we proceed with these savage cuts to the Fire and Rescue Service?
Has an extra minute.
And I thank the member for his intervention. And yes, absolutely right, because part of this conversation is addressing the fact that this service provides a frontline service. And I do call and have called on previous health ministers to define once and for all what frontline services are and to include the role of the Fire and Rescue Service in that. And any such package in relation to any proposed changes to fire service needs to be proofed to do exactly that. So I support the motion and support the amendment as proposed by the SDLP. Thank you.
I call Mr. Kieran McCarthy.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. I must say 5 minutes to discuss such an important issue is far too small, short. Anyway, at the very outset of this debate, let me say loud and clear on behalf of myself, the Alliance Party and the wider community that what we have in the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service are some of the bravest and most courageous people who put their lives on the line to do the job of their choosing, and that is, as has already been said, to save life and limb wherever and whatever the circumstances, even to the point of sacrificing their own lives. That is what I call dedication to the people they serve, and they can only be described as a frontline service and must be regarded as such. Anyone who says or thinks otherwise is, in my opinion, in denial and living in cloud cuckoo land. And I do have to say I welcome the members of the Northern Ireland Fire Rescue Service to this building this afternoon. Mr. Speaker, we only have to listen and watch and read the headlines in our local media last week, where the horrific loss of life of a firefighter of some 25 years' experience, Mr. Joe McCluskey, in 2003, has pained and tortured that family for all of those years. We offer our sympathy to the McCluskey family and indeed any others who have so grievously suffered such a loss of a totally dedicated fireman. That is, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, what constitutes a frontline service. And this Assembly would do well to ever remember the ultimate sacrifice made by Joe McCluskey. And indeed again over this weekend, unfortunately, in Castlewell, as has already been mentioned, a serious fire took the life of a young girl, Ellen Finnegan, and we do sincerely offer our sympathy there. And again, to our firefighters for the excellent work that they have done in trying to save the life of that young girl. Right across, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we all accept the budgetary constraints right across the departments. At the same time, we must accept the huge budget reductions for the Northern Ireland Fire Service over the past number of years. As I understand, a funding reduction of some 14.5% over the last 4 years. This is bound to, it must have, a dramatic effect on the ability to deliver the service that the organisation would wish to offer. And it is important, indeed vital, for the department and for the whole community to remember this is not solely a fire service. It is the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service, which sees personnel attend so many life-saving incidents, including car accidents, again only last week the severe flooding incidents, serious transport incidents, farming incidents, and indeed many more possible disasters, such as medical and cardiac emergencies, all to save lives, and that to prevent tragedies. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, that requires funding. It has to be recognised at present in relation to value for money. Northern Ireland is one of the best performing fire services throughout the UK, with an average cost of 38.72 per head, compared with the average across the water, 43.69 per head of the population. There can be no doubt that any further proposed cuts to the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service budget of around 5.6, maybe even more, will have devastating consequences for everyone, every one of us living in this place. The last thing anyone would wish is station closures, even station downgrades, or firefighter rescuers' numbers being drastically reduced. I would wish to put on record, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, my appreciation of the efforts and acknowledge what has been carried out by the Fire Brigades Union to highlight and convince government, and indeed MLAs here at Stormont, the dire consequences that will surely follow if the Minister and his department cannot sit down with the representatives of this vital service to prevent disaster and move forward together to secure a lasting agreement. In conclusion, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I am aware that the Department has asked, indeed requested, a response, as you would expect from the head of the Fire and Rescue Service, to the Department's plans and proposals for a 5, maybe 10% cuts or savings during this 2016-2017 financial year. And a very detailed reply has been forwarded to the Department outlining what has taken place and over the past years and the limitations to what that can be done
to conclude his remarks.
To further reduce the budget. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, invest in strategy. I would appeal to the Minister. I would appeal to him to listen
ask the member to, conclude
to the
his
senior
remarks.
Officers and make sure that there is sufficient funding for our fire service. Thank you.
I call Mr. Tom Buchanan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate this afternoon, and I rise to support the amendment as tabled in my name and that of my colleagues. I'm glad to see a number of officers in the gallery today. At the very outset, I want to commend the officers and the management of the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service, who over the years have provided an excellent service for the people of Northern Ireland. These are men and women who continually put their own lives at risk each time they are called to the scene of a road traffic accident, a house fire, a flooding incident, or any other emergency incidences that they are called out to. And I know that there are many people right across Northern Ireland today who owe their lives to the work of the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service. And unfortunately, there are those cases where there are also fatalities. And while we express our sincere sympathies to all families in this situation, we must never forget that the officers of the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service who attend such scenes also have to live with that experience and that trauma on a daily basis as they do their job, not knowing what challenges they will have to face the next time that they're called out to some of these incidences. And I know that that can be very stressful for these officers. And I don't think that there is anyone in this House this afternoon who will argue that this is not a key frontline service alongside our ambulance and policing service. I don't think I've heard anyone say that today. And as a party, that is, we're no different than that. We believe that this is a key frontline service alongside our ambulance service and alongside our policing service. As a party, we believe that any change to service delivery must not compromise the safety of either the public or the officers who deliver the service. And that is why we'll give careful consideration to the outcome of the consultation responses to the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service changing risk profile. And I want to deal with some issues within the motion that was brought to the House today, because the motion talks about projected cuts to the service have already resulted in seven stations being identified for downgrading. I don't think this is actually factually correct. The fact is that the Northern Ireland Fire Rescue Service have been carrying out a risk assessment on the delivery of an effective and efficient service based on the changing risk profile of Northern Ireland, not based on the budget, but based on the risk profile of Northern Ireland. This process was actually underway before anyone knew what the budget settlement was. And as yet, the Health Minister, my colleague, has made no decision on the 2016-17 financial allocation to the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service. And I want to refer to what the Acting Chief Fire Officer, Gary Thompson, said. He said, "We have clearly identified a change in the risk profile of Northern Ireland, and we need to adapt and remain flexible to the changing needs that we face. We are confident that this proposal would enable us to make the most effective and efficient use of our operational resources aligned to the risk profile of Northern Ireland. The service will not be impacted by these proposed changes. In fact, Mr. Thompson believes that these proposals to match the risk levels with the appropriate resources will provide an enhanced preventative protection and emergency response while maximising the use of the resources that they have. However, we cannot be complacent on what is a vital key frontline service. And I have listened to the concerns of the officers with regard to moving forward into the future, and that is why today I call on my colleague and Minister for Health, Mr. Hamilton, to work with the Northern Ireland Fire Rescue Service in partnership with the Ambulance Service and the broader health and care sector to ensure that enhanced emergency capability is provided where identified and where required. And I also call on him to give an assurance that any proposal for efficiency savings required by the Executive will only be considered where they do not compromise the public or firefighter
Member
safety
right
across
remarks.
Northern Ireland. I support the amendment.
Ms. Rosie McCauley.
Thank you, Mr. Principal, Deputy Speaker. August Tommy Takulation Rune August Lilasu and SDLP. I'm supporting the motion and the SDLP amendment. Free Las Concordia, nearly in doubt, go a roll rehactuck egnoservice Deutsch on August Tarhilla. There is no doubt that there is that the role of the Fire and Rescue Service is a crucial one, and we all owe a great debt of gratitude to them for keeping us and our community safe. It is an essential service which needs to be available at all times to deal with emergency fires, the rescue of people in road traffic accidents and other dangerous situations. The personnel who carry out these services save lives. They also provide a vital role in educating the public about fire prevention. The Minister stated that he will not preside over unsafe fire and rescue services. However, there is grave concern within the sector that services are being downgraded to such an extent that levels of provision are no longer safe, and it is not regarded by the Minister as a frontline service. The Fire and Rescue Service recently carried out a 5-year assessment and has found that the risk in 11 station areas is not being covered by current provision. 4 stations are being recommended to have an increase in the number of full-time fighters, and That's Dungannon, Enniskillen, Downpatrick and Strabane, but other stations in Coleraine, Carrick, Fergus, Antrim, Portadown, Armagh, Newtownards and Omagh are being proposed to have their opening hours cut from 12 hours to 10 hours daily. As Tashidic Mullu, Gomei Rin Station, Dridgeta, Igdirin, Shachtinia, there's a proposal to close some stations at weekends to reduce the opening hours in others while also maintaining 24-hour cover, and they're thereby content that this is an appropriate level of cover required for the level of risk in the north. To Jarraku Umland Difril, Egancard Cumann and Brigade Drochan Satushkart, the Fire Brigade Union in the north takes a completely different view. The union represents over 95% of all uniformed staff, and therefore their views can be accepted as being a representative voice for firefighters. What they are saying is that there could be risk to life if the proposals to cut opening hours are implemented. Over the last number of years, the budget for the Fire and Rescue Service has reduced by 14.5%, and they could be in line for further cuts of 5 to 6%. The fear is that... Yes, I will.
Member given way. Would the member acknowledge the response given by the Acting Chief Fire Officer to the department when he says that the proposed 5% or even more cuts is neither practical nor safe? Given that, those words from a high-ranking official, would the member agree that for the Minister to go against that would be absolute folly?
Thank the member
has an extra minute.
Thank the member for that intervention, and I totally agree that these levels of cuts are unsafe, and foretell huge risks, I think, to the safety of our society here. The fear is that there will be insufficient money to run a service which is capable of ensuring safety and efficiency. The belief and indeed the fear is that this will ultimately mean that lives and property will be in danger. Currently there is no recruitment and there are 60 unfilled posts. This must be having a negative impact on response times and the weight of response. Given that the number of accidental house fires increased last year, we can only regard this situation with huge concern. Added to that is the additional burden of rescue from flooding, which also falls to the Fire and Rescue Service. As we all have seen, such incidents have become more common and look set to stay so. So that is another pressure on an already tight budget. At the weekend, as other members have referred to, we witnessed the tragic death of Ellen Finnegan in Castle Wellen as a result of a house fire, and nobody can imagine that, you know, the pain that the family is going through, and we offer our condolences to her family and friends. We absolutely do not want to see an increase in the risk of such tragedies occurring, because the budget set aside for the Fire and Rescue Service is below what is required to run a safe and efficient service. This service is far too important to be downgraded in any way. Yes, we can always look for efficiencies, but not at the expense of lives. The budget for the Fire and Rescue Service needs to be guaranteed, as is right and proper, for what is a necessary frontline service. Gura mai agat.
Call Mr Edwin Poots.
Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, I think it's regrettable that we're having this debate today, but nonetheless, we will be able to get some things out into the public domain at this stage with respect to the Fire Service, Fire and Rescue Service, and in that sense it will be useful. Fire and Rescue Service is something that I have had a lot to do with for quite a considerable period now, and I have had many, many meetings with the Fire Brigades Union over the course of the last 5 years. And I have had many things highlighted to me in terms of risk to public safety and so forth. And I generally find that the Fire Brigades Union is a pretty measured group of people, and consequently we seek to pay a fair degree of attention to what they have to say. And over the course of the last number of years, certainly there has been considerable cuts to the Fire Service. A lot of that would have related to the actual management of the Fire Service, and it is no secret that there has been a long period, or there had been a long period, of very poor management of the Fire Service and very poor leadership. Many people would have seen the Fire Service as lions led by donkeys, and we did have a period of colossally bad leadership in the Fire Service, where the people on the ground were doing absolutely sterling work, excellent work, and the people at the head of it were not doing their jobs well at all. And as a consequence of that, for quite a number of years, the money that was allocated to the fire service wasn't spent and couldn't be spent, and consequently the numbers were reduced. But we are at a point of time now where we've been looking at further austerity, further problems in terms of budgeting, and we are hearing a case that is being made that this will do real significant damage to the fire service. So I think that there will be an opportunity for discussions to take place, and there will be an opportunity for us to hear what the fire service have to say, what the fire brigades union have to say, and make decisions based upon that. You know, I look at quite a number of the circumstances where the fire service have went out, and you look at the serious road traffic collisions that have taken place, and the skills that are available nowadays absolutely changed even from 10 or 15 years ago. We look at a number of the call-outs in various difficult situations around chemical spills and so forth, and we look at many really tragic situations, including the one just passed at the weekend where a young woman in Castlewellan lost her life in the most terrible of circumstances, and our hearts go out to that family. Indeed, all of the other families where there has been bereavements recently as a result of fire. And that is a really difficult task, a task any individual to carry out. So we hugely appreciate the work that the Fire and Rescue Service do. We appreciate the non-life-threatening work that they carried out over the course of the last number of weeks in terms of helping to deal with flood situations, helping families who were caught in very, very difficult circumstances in those flood situations. And all of that is something that we recognise. We also see that there are massive opportunities with the fire service as first responders in terms of picking up some of the work at an early point that perhaps other first responders haven't been available to get to as quickly. And I think that there is an opportunity to continue to develop the skills of fire personnel, fire and rescue personnel, in terms of delivering some of those services, and the possibilities of actually closer collaboration between the Fire and Rescue Service and the Ambulance Service. And I welcome the fact that it is to remain in the one department in that instance, because I think that's appropriate. But in all of this, this is a time for listening, it's a time for reflection, it's a time to be paying attention to what people are saying, and see how we can work through these difficult situations. We're living in a period of significant austerity, significant challenges, and we have to find our way through this. And we will find a way through it. And we will find a way through it without putting unnecessary risk to the public in terms of the work that the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service are doing. Thank you, Mr.
Call Mr. Duffy Mackay.
I get a brief last concoyer. I rise to speak in favour of the motion and the SDLP amendment. And can I commend the proposer on bringing this motion forward, and indeed as well the good work of the Fire Brigade Union, who do an excellent job today and always did in terms of keeping members of this House up to speed with the issues within the fire service. And can I indeed welcome the firefighters to the Assembly who are here with us today. We owe them an enormous gratitude. They provide a fantastic service. I couldn't do the job they do. I'm not sure if any member of this House could do what they do. They have seen their share of hell, as already been referred to, the many road traffic collisions, the fatal accidents, the many incidents where people have been injured beyond imagination. They have to deal with that. They have to take that at home at night. And the least we can do is provide them with the resources needed to ensure that they can save as many of those people's lives as possible. Because the fire service is a change in service, and we're not comparing like with like. And I'm always very critical of this notion that whatever happens in England, Scotland and Wales in terms of the equivalent services there, we just have to copy and paste it here. Quite clearly, that should not be the case here. The Chair of the Health Committee has already referred to the fact that in terms of cooperation with the South, we do not have the same resources compared to other services in England, Scotland and Wales who are surrounded with services of a similar capability. So we need to bear that in mind. Of course, the fire and rescue service sometimes, in my view, gets forgotten about lying within the Department of Health, because the Department of Health, as the name suggests, is primarily about health, about hospitals, about frontline services in terms of health. But I think that we need to remind the Minister that this is one of our most important services. It needs the resources, and he needs to look at these figures for what they are, because it's quite clear that in terms of road accidents, in terms of the demands on the fire and rescue service, they are increasing. And therefore, they actually need more resources and not less. And of course, the argument will always be put, you know, there are different agencies, there are different government departments. We're all facing pressures in terms of the Tory cuts. But the fire and rescue service have been feeling the squeeze in each and every one of the last 5 years. And there comes a point where you have to say that you can't cut any deeper. There are services where there is always fat to be cut, but in terms of a service like this, you cut the service, it leads to increased times in terms of getting to that road traffic accident, in terms of getting to that fire where someone may lose their life. And in instances like that, it comes down to seconds, it comes down to minutes, and the more resources they have, the better the chances that someone's life will be saved. And of course, in terms of rural areas, in my view, in terms of a rural representative, it's even more critical, it's even more important. You know, I've been calling for nearly a decade for a new fire station in Ballycastle. I know my colleague Oliver McMullen has been doing the same in terms of Cushendall. So in areas like that there, in rural areas that are named in the briefing paper, they do not need to face any more cuts. And in terms of the overall health budget, as everyone will be well aware, health has over half of the entire budget in terms of the executive. So what the Fire and Rescue Service are asking for is buttons in comparison with the entire budget. You know, the budget for the Fire and Rescue Service is small within the health budget, and therefore this is not a big ask. And in closing, I pray that kind of clear, this Assembly needs to send out...
Would the member give way?
I will.
Would the member agree with me, just in speaking about rural stations, that Strabane, which has been highlighted as a priority station, should be enhanced? But also, I want to take the opportunity of commending the Strabane Fire Services on the good work that they have done at the weekend, where there was a house fire in the Ballycombe estate area of Strabane, where a family narrowly escaped, obviously lost their lives, but lost a family pet in those circumstances. So given that Strabane has been identified as a high priority area, that consideration should be given to Strabane.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. I agree entirely with the member. You look at the towns here, Strabane, Dungannon, Downpatrick, Enniskillen, Portadown, Armagh, Yudnardzoma, Carrickfergus, Antrim and Coleraine, all excellent services in their own right. But this Assembly has gone against ministers before. On a previous occasion, this Assembly made clear that the deal for local firefighters in terms of pensions was not good enough. But what we have on the table here in terms of a cut to the actual frontline service itself, that is not good enough. And I would urge members to support the motion, to support the SDLP amendment, and put the message loud and clear to the Minister that these cuts are not acceptable and they will have a direct impact on people's lives.
As this is the first debate in which the Assembly will hear from Mr. Gerard Diver, I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. That is, unless Mr. Diver provokes an interruption in the remarks that he uses. I call Mr. Gerard Diver.
Thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And I rise today in support of the SDLP motion to which I put my name. in support of the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service, and I'll come back to that in a moment. I want to first of all take this opportunity to pay tribute to my predecessor in the Assembly, Mr Pat Ramsay. Pat served the people of the Foyle constituency with distinction from 2003 to the end of December last, and I am honoured to take his place in this Assembly. His hard work, dedication and relentless ability to work on behalf of his constituents is something which I hope to emulate and to replicate in my work in the Assembly, so I look forward to it. Returning to today's debate, obviously I want to personally pay tribute to the firefighters within the service who have often risked their lives for safety and protection of others. As has been said in this chamber already, they put their lives at danger day and daily on our behalf. And we would do well to remember that, perhaps, when we're talking about percentages and trying to save money in the overall budget. It is often overlooked, the fact that the fire service is as much of a frontline service as any other in respect of the health budget. Other than the conventional putting out of fires, as has been said here today, there are a multitude of other roles which the Fire and Rescue Service perform day and daily. Those include the horrific traffic collisions that they have to attend, the work that they've done over recent times, particularly on the issue of flooding, and building collapses as well. In fact, as my colleague Fergal has said, over the last year, the fire service have responded to a total of almost 23,000 incidents of this type. That's a monumental workload for any organisation, I think, and I think we have to pay tribute to that. In the most recent flooding incidents that we've had here locally, Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker, we have seen over the last few weeks the devastating impact that the flooding has had, and importantly, how the role of acting quickly, which the fire service has been able to do, has played such a key role in the protection of homes and businesses by helping to prevent harm and recover damages that have occurred to their property. Any reduction to their budget may lack foresight, as a suite of services that have a cross-departmental significance will be affected. Let's look at the fire service budget specifically. From 2011, the Northern Ireland Fire Rescue Service has had to operate in spite of year-on-year cuts. There has been no decrease in demand, and as a result, the fire service has been stretched by operating in harsher budgetary climate than every year. In that time, their budget has been cut by 14.5%. But this represents, as has been said in the House, over £12 million between 2011 and 2016. We heard Mr Buchanan refer to earlier the fact that there is no statement yet about further cuts in the budget that's to be discussed tomorrow. I'm afraid we don't have that confidence at the moment. We wonder about what is to come. And if is what is suspected, that there may be in fact another 5.6% cut, this Assembly must ask itself whether it is content that during this current mandate it will have removed one-fifth of the budget for the fire service funding, which I think is something that we all have to think about. Furthermore, the Fire Brigade Union has said that the planned 5.6% cut would mean that the service would be unable to fulfil its statutory requirements. We must act now, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker. That 5% cut would also lead to the loss of 67 full-time firefighters' posts and the closure of 3 one-pump stations, or multi-pump stations and one-pump stations. Even the slightest cut can make a significant difference. Ms McLaughlin, speaking earlier on, referred to the situation in our own constituency of Foyle. In the Northern Road fire station, it recently had to downgrade its VEMA aerial appliance so that it couldn't be manned 24 hours a day, but used only on request. This led to the reduction of 3 personnel and protracted waiting times for such fires using that aerial appliance. The VEMA appliance was often used to good effect. For example, during the recent Brickland fire, which was a huge fire in our city and district, which burned for approximately 1 week, pouring water onto the blaze from that high level without firefighters entering the building and putting their lives at risk. So the SDLP amendment to this motion is proposed by my colleague Fergal McKinney. Firstly, asserts that the fire service constitutes a critical frontline service and calls for the Minister for Health to seek executive approval to ring-fence that budget. So we already have a fire service that can operate efficiently.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Efficiently in harsh budgetary conditions. They have demonstrated as much, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, and I would like people to support the SDLP motion that has been put before the House today. Thank you.
Call Mr Adrian Cochrane-Watson. Principal Deputy Speaker. Mr. Speaker, in my early years, I was brought up by my grandfather, a retained firefighter for 30 years. And I know the sacrifice that the men and women in the service give. I know the sacrifice that their families give. And I am humbled by them every day. I was also honoured 18 months ago, the former Minister Jim Wales made me a member of the Fire and Rescue Service Board. And I was part of a board that implemented some of these cuts, reluctantly. And I can tell the House that we went to the department, the then Chief Fire Officer Chris Kerr, and the board went and said, that is it, enough is enough. Operationally, you are now going to be unsafe. Don't listen to my words, listen to the words of the present acting Chief Fire Officer, Dale Ashford. A devastating impact, unacceptable risk levels, and something which isn't touched upon, the reduction in training of these fine men and women could lead to a risk of corporate manslaughter. That's what we're faced with by further possible cuts of the service. When I joined the Fire and Rescue Service, one of the most important tools to senior management is Gartan, and it talks about the operational availability. And I'd like to ask the House, are they happy that 19 fire stations breached the safe operational availability this morning? The DUP proposer on his amendment paid praise, and rightly so, to the men and women of Northland and Crescent Link. Is he comfortable that at 12 minutes past 9 this morning, those two stations breached, meaning they did not have enough operational strength to meet the needs of his community? In my constituency, Ballyclare breached. In the Minister's constituency, I believe it's served by Carrie Duff, it was breached at 12 minutes past 9. I could go on, but is that acceptable? When we're looking at further cuts, 19 local fire stations breached operational safety this morning. I would also remind the House, or inform the House, this is a good day. I've seen Garton showing me 30 stations breached. I don't believe that's unacceptable. I believe that's unacceptable. I also would highlight the fact, as brought to us today by the Fire Brigade Union, some statistics, and let's not argue with these. Their injuries are up by 43 to 559, the highest in 5 years. Rescues are up by 29 to 208. Fatalities, very sadly, are up 15 to 46. An awful lot of the good work which this service done was educational and awareness raising. And they've done it through a medium of television, radio, and on one-to-one, where officers give, on many occasions, their own time, getting to schools, meeting community groups. And sadly, an awful lot of that work, due to operational needs, has now been cut back. I will be supporting the motion brought by my colleague, and I'll be supporting the amendment brought by the SDLP today. And I urge all those who were so pleased to welcome the fire officers in the Great Hall, who were so pleased to get their photographs taken by them, I hope they will support those men and women who are here today. Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker.
I call the Minister of Health and Social Services and Public Safety, Mr. Simon Hamilton, to respond to the debate, and the Minister has up to 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Firstly, can I join with, I think, practically every contributor to today's debate to personally acknowledge and thank the dedication and professionalism of our brave firefighters in carrying out their what can often be dangerous duties on a daily basis to protect life and property across Northern Ireland. This has been particularly evident, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, recently in the responses to a number of serious fire incidents, which have been mentioned by speakers today, and indeed road traffic incidents, and of course a widespread flooding in parts of our province in the last number of weeks. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, the Fire and Rescue Service is a vital frontline service. The very nature of its work dictates that. I have no issue with what has been said in respect of that and have not decided otherwise. They are not, as the motion asserts, a service under attack. In providing their services, the Fire and Rescue Service must be efficient and effective, providing the best possible fire and rescue service informed by sound evidence and evidential base and risk analysis, and public and firefighting safety will not be compromised. We must recognise that there has been a continuing reduction in emergency calls received and mobilisations by firefighters to reported incidents. There was 22,781 incidents were mobilised in 2014-15, and that was down 5.3% on the previous year, and it was down 26% on 2010-2011. The long-term trend in Northern Ireland mirrors that in England in terms of reduced mobilisations and reductions in the number of dwelling fires and secondary fires year on year. In England, this has been matched with a 22% reduction in central funding for fire authorities and 14% fewer full-time staff employed by English fire authorities since 2010. In Northern Ireland, the comparative figures are approximately 9.7% and 3.3% respectively, a far more favourable situation in Northern Ireland. The reduction in incidents combined with the development of up-to-date risk profiles provides an opportunity for the Fire and Rescue Service to review how and where it deploys its resources across Northern Ireland to address the risk to the public and ensure firefighter safety in delivering its services. They cannot stand still. The professional opinion of the Fire and Rescue Service, not of me, but of the Fire and Rescue Service, of the level of current risk suggests that existing whole-time firefighter resource could be rebalanced appropriately and proportionately across Northern Ireland to better address the level of risk to the public and its own firefighters. I think, Mr. Deputy Speaker, listening to the debate, there have been a conflation of two issues. One is the proposals made by the Fire and Rescue Service themselves, which I'll come on to now, and the other is concerns about cuts in next year's budget, which we'll come on to later. The professionals' view is that the proposals would result in improved cover. These are the proposals that are out for consultation. Would result in improved cover in the rural areas, in rural areas and west of the band. So stations like Downpatrick, Dungannon, Strabane, as was mentioned during the debate, and Enniskillen. One of the main benefits outlined in the Fire and Rescue Service proposals is a significant increase in the number of life-threatening incidents which can be attended by whole-time firefighters across Northern Ireland as a result of redeployment. The proposals are out for public consultation, as I've mentioned, and that will run until the 7th of March of this year. And I'd encourage people to look carefully at them and provide feedback to the Fire and Rescue Service. Fire and Rescue Service must continually look for new and better ways of delivering its services while ensuring that firefighter and public safety continues to be the priority. I recently met with the Chair and the Interim Chief Fire Officer of the Fire and Rescue Service, and I know how keen they are to explore opportunities for new ways of working, particularly in terms of joint approaches to improving frontline emergency services and to tackling wider societal issues, including health and well-being. Firefighters working with other emergency responders have the potential to relieve pressure in other areas of the health and social care system. I know that such joint approaches have been trialled successfully in several English Fire and Rescue authorities. Working in partnership is at the very heart of the Fire and Rescue Service's activities, and going forward I believe that collaboration is key. Continuing to work with and build on the partnerships with other agencies will be vitally important. Emergency response standards must take into account the most recent available evidence base and risk assessment. The Fire Service considers that the current emergency response standards, which were introduced 10 years ago, are no longer fit for purpose. The existing emergency response standards are currently under review, and any changes will be subject to public consultation. There are many challenges to be faced by the Fire and Rescue Service in the coming months and years. Unlike health and social care, their budget has not been protected by the executive. And while I've yet to take any final decisions on the 2016 17 financial allocation for the Fire and Rescue Service. I think that's it's an important point that, again, has perhaps deliberately been some being ignored during this debate. The 5 and 10% reductions that were talked about were carried out as an exercise conducted by not just my department, but indeed by all departments, on the instruction of the Department of Finance and Personnel in planning for what was a difficult budget, as members of this House will know very well. I reiterate the point again, two points in fact, that no decisions have yet been taken in respect of the Fire and Rescue Services budget for next year, or indeed any aspect of the health and social care budget at all. And none, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, will be taken that jeopardise or endanger firefighter or public safety. No proposals, as some have suggested, have been made other than the evidence-based changes which have been put forward and suggested and proposed by the Fire and Rescue Service themselves. They are changes which are not, I repeat, not about efficiency or savings, but are rather about delivering services more effectively. Those proposals, as I said, are being consulted upon by the Fire and Rescue Service, and they clearly state a point ignored by some in their contributions that, quote, no stations face closure or a reduction in the number of fire engines based there as a result of the proposals being put forward by the Fire and Rescue Service. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I think there have been some scaremongering today, some talk of savage cuts was, I think, one of the quotes that was made by one of the members. But at this point in time, as I've said before, there are no budgetary proposals in place for the Fire and Rescue Service or indeed any other aspect of the department's budget. And when I mention budget, I think it's probably worth then turning to some of the points that were mentioned about the budget. Everyone says in this chamber that they understand the budget pressures that my department and the whole executive are facing, but we don't always hear in this chamber anyway, and sometimes outside of it, a demonstration of an understanding of the pressures that my department's budget and the executive's budget as a whole are facing. Look, I would be quite content if there was full protection afforded to my department's budget. I would be quite content with that, and if the executive agreed that, as indeed one of the amendments is suggesting. But I also have to be, as I would urge the whole House to be, realistic about these things in a situation where we are facing considerable downward pressure in the actual resource that we have, and indeed all of the other pressures that the whole of the executive is facing. More money for one service means coming at the expense of money from another service. And I heard Dathy Mackay in his contribution say that what he was looking for, which he didn't define, was not a big ask, which I suppose is true in the context of not just the health and social services and public safety department's budget, but in the context of the whole executive's budget, a budget, of course, which he and his party have supported. But he, like other contributors to the debate, and indeed I'm sure there's a budget debate tomorrow, I'm sure there's similar contributions will be made during that budget tomorrow, there'll be all sorts of asks for money for here and there and this and that and the other, but precious few ideas coming forward as to where that money should come from, and the member was no exception to that, nor were members from the SDLP or indeed other parties who asked for more money for the Fire and Rescue Service. No bright ideas about where, what other departments' money should be taken from, or in the event that there was no protection offered to the totality of my department's budget. And let's not forget, my department got a very generous budget settlement, the most generous of all of the departments for next year, coming at the expense of reductions, significant reductions in other departments' budget. But there was no suggestion made as to where, if in the event that there is no protection for the my department's budget, where elsewhere within health and social care that money should come from. So, you know, there is no suggestions made, just the typical usual, which I'm well used to in this job and in previous jobs, of asking for more money but not suggesting where that money might come from. And while we're on the point of finances, in respect of the Fire and Rescue Service's own budget, which I acknowledge has reduced in terms of its opening position over the last number of years, Mr. Putz in his contribution mentioned reductions in budgets, which are, yes, were reduced from a height of 81 million in 2011-2012 down to 73 million in this year. He mentioned in his contribution, rightly mentioned contributions, that for many of those years there had been underspend, considerable underspend within the Fire and Rescue Service. And if we are debating more money for the Fire and Rescue Service, I think it's important to bear in mind what financial performance has actually been in the Fire and Rescue Service over the last 4 years. And over the last 4 years, there has been an underspend of some £13.2 million in those 4 years by the Fire and Rescue Service, including an underspend of £2.7 million last year, which was the year, of course, where some parties in this House were seeking to give more money to the Fire and Rescue Service, which had underspent by £2.7 million in that year. So sometimes, you know, asking for more money, it is worthwhile bearing in mind. I'm sure that the Chair will be interested, the Chair of the Committee will be interested in those points around underspend within the Fire and Rescue Service. And if you're looking for more money, it's worth bearing in mind financial performance as it currently stands. But, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I have yet to take any final decisions on the 2016-17 financial allocation for the Fire and Rescue Service, but in common with all public services, they need to continually demonstrate that service delivery is based on a sound evidence base, with deployment of its resources in line with the appropriate professional risk assessment and ensuring the continued safety of the public and of firefighters. In closing, I wish to state that I fully appreciate the importance of the Fire and Rescue Service, and my position on the service is quite clear. Services it provides must be of the highest quality, with a focus on prevention and protection. Its resources must be allocated across Northern Ireland based on the professional assessment of risk. It must continually look for new and better ways of delivering its services, challenging what it does, how it does it, and engaging in consulting with the people that it serves. The potential for greater partnership and collaborative approaches to the provision of emergency services must be further explored and developed in order to deliver better outcomes for the public. We must look to the future and continue to support and build a modern and efficient Fire and Rescue Service that its staff and firefighters are proud to work in and that the community have full confidence in. My department will continue to work closely with the Fire and Rescue Service to ensure that it provides a professional, responsive and value for money service, and firefighter and public safety remains my priority. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, my focus is on ensuring that the health, social care and public safety services provided are safe and effective while seeking to achieve financial balance for my department. Thank you.
I call Mr. Alex Easton to wind on amendment number 2, and the member has up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise to support my party's amendment and to wind. The Northern Ireland Fire Service protects and serves the entire population of Northern Ireland and responds to fires, road traffic collisions and many other emergencies, and are a vital frontline service. The Northern Ireland Fire Service currently operates 4 duty systems for firefighters to deliver emergency response and to carry out prevention and protection activities. On full-time cover, these stations are crewed 24 hours a day, all year round, by firefighters on full-time contracts. On variable crew cover, these stations are crewed by firefighters on full-time contracts for a 12-hour period from 7:30 to 1,930 hours all year round. Outside of these hours, varied crewed stations are crewed by retained deputy system firefighters contracted to travel from their homes or places of work to the fire station. On retained duty system cover, these stations are crewed by firefighters contracted to travel from their home or place of work to the fire station to enable them to respond to incidents. The current full-time firefighter and variable crewing day shift starts and finishes times are incompatible. This inhibits efficient movement of firefighters from one duty system to the other to meet any deficiencies in crewing levels. It is proposed that realigning duty shifts across the service will enable them to move firefighters more freely for, in the first instance, temporary coping mechanisms due to crewing shortfalls, and secondly, to redeploy resources if required on a longer-term basis to meet emerging challenges to the risk profile of Northern Ireland. To meet the needs of the community, the Northern Ireland Fire Service has to continually monitor and measure all risks to ensure our service delivery remains effective and efficient. A risk model has been developed using analysis of 5 years of incident data from 2010-11 to 2014-15. This model weights life risk incidents and takes account of all other emergency responses incidents. Data on the Northern Ireland Fire Service response to incidents shows that the overall demand for emergency response has decreased by 2.7% from 2011 to 2014-15. However, the overall number of fatalities and casualties from 2011 to 2015 has increased. Following an analysis of emergency incidents in 2006, the Northern Ireland Fire Service introduced a variable crew shift to cover the hours from 1100 to 2300 each day. This was in an attempt to provide a faster response while enabling crews to fulfil statutory duties of community engagement to drive down risk. The agreed shift pattern also considered to a lesser extent the impact on firefighters' family life. At that time, the new variable crewing shift system was introduced as a phased upgrade to 7 fire stations from a retained duty system crewing model to one that included a whole-time firefighting element for particular periods of the day. Up to the date, risk analysis completed by the Northern Ireland Fire Service has identified a number of retained stations where the risk to the community would benefit from an enhanced emergency response. That operational demand on these retained stations is similar or even higher than that within existing variable crewed stations. The Northern Ireland Fire Service believe that moving to a day crewing system is and its ability to free up 28 posts for redeployment provides a more cost-effective and efficient service model. The proposed change to a day crewing model supports an increased spread of the whole-time emergency response from the 7 variable crews stations to 11 areas. Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker, having visited Bangor Fire Station on several occasions and having seen firsthand the excellent work our firefighters do, they have my full support and gratitude. The Fire Service is a frontline service, and of course it is a frontline service, and we all accept that. The 7 stations referred to are not being downgraded, and it is not because of the budget. Careful assessment of risk by Fire Service found would be better to change the crewing rota at the 7 stations and be able to introduce whole-time crewing at 4 stations in Enniskillen, Dungannon, Downpatrick and Strabane. This is currently out for consultation and is based on the Fire Service's own risk assessing. Having spoken to a representative of the Fire Brigades Union, they did not want this debate to become a political debate and wanted to continue working with the parties to try and resolve any issues that there are. Finally, Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker, nothing has been decided by the Fire Service yet on their own consultation, and nothing has been decided on the budget for the following financial year. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker.
I call Mr. John Dollett to wind on amendment number 1, and the member will have up to 5 minutes.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I welcome the opportunity to wind on our amendment and to thank the Ulster Unionist and Joanne Dobson in particular for bringing the motion in the first place. Later on I will make reference to one fireman who lost his life, and indeed Kieran McCarthy has already done that, and make reference to that later. At the outset, can I say I'm astonished, being an old codger about this place, that I think for the first time not a single member of the party opposite would give way to an intervention. And I think that absolutely destroyed the opportunity for the cut and thrust of politics and to develop the arguments. Let me say that, before I go further, would you at least let me get started? Sorry, Mr. Pitt. You do want to give... Mr. Speaker, before we go any further, I'd like to commend the men and women within the Northern Ireland Fire Service at ground level capacity. I can think of no more courageous act than entering into burning property in the pursuit of saving lives, and indeed going to road traffic incidents where people are severely injured or indeed dead or dying. I, like others today, believe that firefighters are special people with great inner strength and resilience to carry out the tasks, and I wholeheartedly salute the men and women who carry out those tasks. As I said at the outset, I want to pay tribute to one fireman in particular from Dungiven, and that's Joe McCluskey. And as Kieran McCarthy has said, last week the Attorney General published a report indicating that he knew the identity of the person who gave the order for that man to go on a roof, where he consequently fell to his death. Later on Thursday, I had a phone call from a retired police officer who confirmed what the Attorney General had said was in fact true. And I make a plea today to the Minister and to the senior management of the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service who are present in this building, and indeed to anyone else who will support the McCluskey family in bringing final conclusion to a dreadful event, which for them was devastating. Indeed, in reference to Mr. Poots earlier, he described the fire service as, I'm sure, a very good service for years led by donkeys. And I couldn't agree more. That's exactly what it was. And it was the donkeys who made the decision not to grant the independent inquiry, which would have brought out the truth. Now, I make no apologies for labouring that point, because it's important. And on a day like this, when we pay tribute to the firemen and firewomen, that we do acknowledge that there's one outstanding injustice which needs to be cleared up. And I particularly appeal to the Fire Brigade Union, who are also present in the building, to remember their former colleague and to renew their endeavours to ensure that justice is done. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, in relation to the money, and I'm sure the Minister probably was waiting on me to come to that, we probably don't have all the time today to do it, but look, in his department alone, there's £50 million a year that goes on substitutes because people are off work. But I won't zone in on his department alone. Members know that £4.2 million went to substitute teachers, paid for sitting at home. And out of the 106 that were suspended, only 6 actually were sacked. So look, this Assembly is in no position to say that savings can't be made. But for God's sake, the first port of call is surely not the emergency services. And those of us who have lived through the past know all too well the contribution that they made to life and limb and protecting property through the darkest days. I have to say that there are other issues that will arise where the Minister, quite frankly, has not addressed. Coleraine is going down. Cushendall, Ballycastle. Yes, indeed, of course.
Any proposal to reduce the number of full-time fire officers will actually increase response times and lead, perhaps, to more problems, more injuries and more deaths.
The member has an extra
minute. I thank the member for his intervention. And, you know, perhaps our DUP friends might have realised that they could have had an extra minute to make their case. Of course, there are long-term consequences of the path that we're on. And in the future, when it is recognised that this is a disastrous course, it will take years and years to put it right. There is a service there. It serves the whole community, both full-time and indeed retained. And
ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Well, of course, and I will indeed just exactly on the dot. Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker.
I call Mr. Michael McGimsey to conclude and wind up the debate on the substantive motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and can I thank all those members who contributed today to this debate. I think it's been a very interesting debate. I also think it's been a very good debate, and a lot of issues have been brought forward as far as the proposed efficiency cuts to the fire service are concerned. I think the first thing we have to say, and we all acknowledge, that the fire service in Northern Ireland, we have a very, very good fire service. It's professional, it's dedicated to delivering a service to the people of Northern Ireland. It does routinely, on a day and daily basis, provide a service that saves lives and also prevents injury. It is a service that is under pressure and has been under pressure for some time, and it is a service that has gone as far as it can go as far as taking those pressures. And the fire service themselves are saying enough is enough. And I think when Edmund Poots is saying we have to stop and listen, I think we need to be listening to our fire service, we need to be listening to our personnel, we need to be listening to the crews who have taken time off their own time to come here to emphasise the point that they feel that they are not being properly and fairly treated and allowed to deliver the service that they expect to deliver, that they want to deliver.
I thank the member for giving way. Again, I posed a question to the member, and the minister is here. The minister heard what was said in relation to the reply given by the acting chief fire officer, that if he is forced to make 5% or even more cuts, that is neither practical nor safe for the people of Northern Ireland. The minister has heard that. I think I actually give credit to the minister. He acknowledged that, but it's his actions as from this day onwards.
Can I thank the member? Yes, indeed I agree. Not safe for the public, not practical, but also not safe for the fire crews themselves. And we must always remember that the safety of crews must be paramount. And when I was a minister, and no doubt when Evan was a minister, we operated under a principle of safe to manage. That was having the optimum crews and optimum supervision, whatever was needed to attend an incident. And it appears to be that is a guiding principle that has slipped. And there's the old issue of, as the rescuers go in to rescue, if they get into trouble, who rescues the rescuers? They must have the support. They must have absolute principle guaranteed that we look, as they put their lives on the line, as they risk their own safety, that we have backup and support for them. And it appears to me that is not the case at the moment. I think that it's quite clear the money's been going down. It's going down 2011, 81.6 million, 2015, 69.7 million. We're now down to somewhere around 65 million. The money's going down, and I think it's preposterous to try and say that it will not compromise the service, it will not compromise crew, or will not compromise the public. And I think anybody who says that is really not working their way through. We've seen the personnel going down. The personnel in 2011, 915 full-time to 845 to 817. We're now 100 less. So we're trying to provide a service to the people of Northern Ireland with less money and with less personnel. And that has been reflected in the response times, because the response times are not as good as they used to be, from 75% in 2010 in 6 minutes down to 59%. And we're aware in discussing things like ambulances, and it's just as clear with a fire service as well, that I'll give away in a moment, that response times are key. And the faster the response time, the more likely the successful outcome of dealing with the incident. And there's another issue here I want to deal with. And they're saying that, or it has been claimed or stated, that there's 26% fewer mobilisations. But yet the number of fatalities is rising and the number of injuries is rising. Now that suggests to me that the incidents are more serious that they're going out to. And I think that actually argues against the point that Simon Hamilton is making with this reduction. They're clearly dealing with more serious incidents, and therefore they need support. They're a very efficient organisation. Their cost per head of population is less than it is in the rest of the UK. They're the most efficient organisation, the fire service, in the UK. And also, as Maeve McLaughlin has said, they're not able to borrow from fire services that they are in England and Wales and Scotland, from other fire services in the area. They have to be a standalone. They get some support on occasion and very welcome cross-border, but the fact is that they have to stand alone. I think Ms. McLaughlin wanted to...
Thank you, and I thank the member for giving way. Can I ask the member, maybe does he agree with me, at a time when we see upwards of 55 million over the last 5 years that was paid as clinical excellence awards, in essence bonuses, to senior consultants, is actually unacceptable when we are faced with a fire service that are quite literally struggling to save lives.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Without getting into that argument, there is a national pay deal as far as consultants are concerned, and doctors and nurses and so on are concerned, and woe behind us if we break away from that. Now, as far as clinical excellence, that is a different issue, but I think there's clearly available funds to deal with proposed cuts that we're looking at, although the Minister tells us no decision has been made. And we're told by, and Tom Buchanan tells us, no decision made on downgrades at Portadown, Armagh, Newton Ards, Omagh, Carrickfergus, Antrim and Coleraine. I suggest that you tell the Fire Brigade Union, because that's not their view. But presumably you have, and they actually don't believe you. I think we're looking at also the proposal to high-risk towns, four major towns at higher risk, Strabane, Dungannon, Downpatrick and Enniskillen. Now, we're told by the Minister and we're told by Mr Buchanan that that's not the case. Well, I think somebody needs to tell the Fire Brigade Union, or presumably somebody has, and they don't believe you. But I think it's quite clear that this very professional service understands what's coming. They know what actually is proposed, never mind what we're being told here today. A number of points have been made by a number of members, and I think some of them are excellent points. I will actually say that, as far as the proposer and signer is concerned, the amendment from the SDLP is quite acceptable to us, and we're happy to support that. We're not happy to support the DUP amendment. And in fact, when Gary Middleton and Tom Buchanan got up and spoke, they appeared to be speaking against their own amendment with the arguments they made, and then they settled down by saying, oh, we will support the DUP amendment. But their arguments all appeared to be in a contrary direction, and it appears to be either they're walking both sides of the street at the same time, or they don't actually believe what they've been told. And I think that is an important issue. We have our proposal suitably amended, calling all members of this House to support it. But I'm told that the fire service has been underspending. There's a number of reasons why you underspend or can't underspend. It may be that they weren't allowed to spend. It may be that there's vacancy controls in place that allows them to actually spend money on recruitment to replace personnel. And of course, 80% of their budget goes in personnel. It may be that that's one of the areas that has prevented them from actually spending out their budget. But never mind that. We're now looking at cuts. We're looking at reductions. It is disgraceful that we are doing so. We have a first-class fire service here. Now, let's not do any more damage to it than has been done recently as far as cuts are concerned. We need to keep it in place, because every one of us, including the Minister and the proposer of the DUP amendment and so on, we all will need this support sometime in our lives, and we all want to make sure that support is in place. So I therefore implore everybody to unanimously support the amendment. There can be no cuts. We're told they're not even happening anyhow, possibly. There should be no cuts to the fire service budget, and we look to repair the damage that has been done over the past number of years. Our population is rising, the risks are rising, the incidents are more serious, the fatalities are rising, the injuries are rising. We have an opportunity now to give the fire service the support to address that. Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker.
Before I put the question on Amendment 1, I would remind members that if it is made, I will not put the question on Amendment 2. The question is that Amendment 1, standing in the names of Mr Fergal McKinney, Mr Gerard Diver and Mr John Dallet, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned. Yes, ahead.